And it's always great to have a guest in here. And this one passed the audition last time. He passed the audition last time. And so we unlocked the door, the front door again, and he's down here again. It's been almost, it's been actually over a year since Jason was here. And he's got a new CD. We'd like to welcome back to KSYM, Jason James.
Hey, what's going on, Dave? How you doing?
Man, we were talking, and I thought it had only been springtime or summertime when last time you were here. But you were talking about a new CD coming up. The baby is finally
born.
It's hatched.
Yeah, just
and
as ugly as
it is a killer CD.
Thanks, bro.
We were talking. It's going to be in my top 10 for sure.
All right.
This year, because what you're doing these days is sort of rare in music, in recorded music or radio spins, at least what I hear these days.
Wow. Yeah, it's definitely a little different than most of the other stuff that's out there, but I appreciate you spinning the record.
Let me go back again. This is Jason James. He's playing tonight over at the Lonesome Rose. He's got a new CD called Seems Like Tears Ago. And last time he was here, he was talking about a new CD. He was promoting his last CD. And now he's gone out on your own with your own record label and jumped into the deep end and seeing how well you sink or swim, right?
I guess so, yeah. I figured, you know, if I was going to sink, I don't need any help with anybody else. I can do it on my own.
Now, on this new CD, definitely you can pick out some George Jones inflection in that and other and influences, I guess, that have affected your songwriting and your musical tastes. What in it? How do you think you make it your own?
You know, I mean, it's kind of the same with fingerprints. You know, they're all different. Even if you try to emulate somebody, it would just be a bad version of emulating them. So I try to just be honest to myself and what I want to listen to, and just take it that way, take that approach. You know, there's going to be inflections of different people that you're influenced in, you know, and I wear them proud on my sleeve, you know. It's about honoring the tradition of country music too, you know, because, I mean, you know, they say I sound like George Jones or I have George Jones inflections, but, you know, George Jones reminds me of Roy Acuff when he sings.
Yeah.
So, and Ernest Tubb. So it's like, you know, using the influences of bringing everything together and kind of making it your own feeling.
Yeah. And I assume you watched the Ken Burns.
Oh, yeah, you know it.
That was very entertaining and very informative, I thought. There was plenty of things. I mean, I'm not expecting to be a country music expert by any means, but I mean, just the visuals that went along with the narration.
Yeah, it was great.
Just some very cool stuff.
It was put together so great too, you know, and it's such a just vast 50 years, more than that, with recorded history, you know, of music. So I thought they did a good job of getting some people in there. I personally wish there would have been some more Lefty Frizzell and stuff, but I think considering how much they covered, they did a really great job. I have no complaints.
And I was sort of interested in it was interesting to say that sort of country music in the Carter family and that kind of stuff, almost that helped start radio, musical radio,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah. You know, and it's funny too, you know, once again about influences and then thinking about the Carter family, how they would travel from town to town and basically take other people's music and record it, you know, and all of these old hymns and stuff, all the melodies were all had been used before, so it's kind of cool to watch everything kind of go full circle. But the outlaw one is what really got me. The one, it was right when I was leaving my label too, you know, and I was just about to put this record out, so it came out at a perfect time, and it was unbeknownst to my management, or I wish we could claim credit for that, but
what you're saying, just people are like, oh
yeah, you know, it started
this is
a lot
real
of
country music.
Well,
this
yeah,
what,
you know, and they were fresh off the documentary, and mine came out in October. You know, it was right when it was starting to pick up.
Right.
So it was awesome. It was perfect timing.
Talking
I
to,
wish I could have taken credit for it.
Well,
Maybe I will.
Maybe you will.
I'm going to take credit for it in another interview.
Definitely. Talking to Jason James. He's traveling in support of his new CD, Seems Like Tears Ago. Playing tonight over at the Lonesome Rose. You got a guitar with you?
How about picking
us a tune, please?
All right. Tell you what. I'll play a little bit of the single that we've had going on the Americana charts. A tune called Move a Little Closer.
Well, I'm sick and tired of hanging around, waiting for you to decide. If you're gonna love me, I better learn pretty quick just who's on your side. When I started talking, it's best you started listening, 'cause honey, baby, this ain't right. You better move a little closer before I say it's over and daddy totes it down the line. Well, you call me on the telephone, sound as sweet can be, saying all the things you wanna do with me. I light up like a Christmas tree, and then you leave me on the line while you hang me out to dry. You better move a little closer before I say it's over and daddy tilts it down the line. I lie awake at night, haven't heard a word from you in days. I've never met a girl who could let me down a thousand different ways. Loving you's like sleeping on the tracks, I'm just waiting around to die. You better move a little closer before I say it's over and daddy tilts it down the line. At night, haven't heard a word from you in days. I've never met a girl who could let me down a thousand different ways. I feel like a baby just laying in the crib, so mama, please hear my cry. You better move a little closer before I say it's over and daddy tilts it down the line. I thought by me loving you, life would be so sweet. But nothing's changed in this world of mine, I'm staring in defeat. I've got more bags underneath my eyes than the ones you left with last night. You better move a little closer before I say it's over and daddy totes it down the line. You better move a little closer before I say it's over and daddy totes it down the line.
Yeah, Jason James, a live version of a track off his new CD, Seems Like Tears Ago. Jason James playing tonight with a full band over at the Lonesome Rose. I believe Elena Kay opening up that gig. Explain who's, talk about the CD now. John Evans produced it?
That's right. John Evans produced it, and we had a bunch of really great Austin players, pickers that were on it.
Folks that John had worked with in the past, or is
well,
that...
the bass player he did, you know, that's a sidecar Jake from Two Tons. It's on this record.
Oh, okay.
He played bass and he used to play with John. So we just kind of assembled some of the best pickers that weren't that would suit us, you know. But I was on a show; it was like a Christmas show or something at the Broken Spoke, and this steel player that I had hired, he came recommended, ended up being on the record. But I called John after it was over. I was like, hey man, I want this guy on my record. He's like, well, okay man, I've already got the pickers picked. I was like, no, you don't understand, this cat's great.
And where was he from?
That's a good question. I think he's an Austin guy. Yeah, he's staying in Austin.
Have you met him before?
I did. He played on the show with me. Well, he says I met him. No, he played with me on the show at the Broken Spoke, and I called John and told him about this guy, and he was like, we already got the players we needed. But I was like, no, you really like this guy. And he was like, well, what's his name? And I said, his name's Jeff, you know, Jeff Queen. He's like, oh, yeah, that guy's already on the record. Like, we've already got him scheduled. It's like, cool, all right.
Well, awesome. That was a hurdle you didn't have to, wasn't too tough to get over.
No, that wasn't too bad at all.
And were you familiar with John? Were you friends with John? How'd you pick John to sort of produce this thing?
John produced a lot of my first record. He actually went to bat for me at the record label whenever they cut the check for us to go in and record the first. It was going to be an EP at first, and if they got a green light, then they were going to, you know, fund the rest of the record, which they did. But he went to Houston and grabbed the first one, and I met him probably 6 months to a year before that. It was like my second gig, and we had no business being at the Saxon Pub open, and we were just not put together yet. But he went on before us, which was even worse. But after he was playing, you know, he like lit the bass on fire and stuff. He had the doghouse bass, and it was just like, oh my God, how are we gonna follow this? I'm just gonna play some sad cheating country songs and see if
and he's rocking out.
Oh man, it was just I couldn't believe it. I was like, there is just no why did I take this gig? But I ended up talking to him afterwards, and we hit it off, and he stuck around and came and hung out. He's like, man, what you're doing is, there's nobody doing that, so we need to get this on tape. So we went and made a record.
Yeah. So you had it done before you went to over to New West and
had done before they officially signed me with New West. And then while we were in I'd signed with New West, and then some new management came in and they flew me to Nashville, and Keith Gaddis did the rest of the record. So
Did he understand what you were into?
Oh yeah. Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah. Gaddis was great.
But then what I understand is then they said, if you do something else, can you maybe not be so country? Was that right?
Man, it's been talked about 100 different ways. Basically what came down to it was the songs that are on this record were pitched to them and they didn't give a green light for any of them. And kind of suggested maybe, you know, to go a little bit more on the Americana route. And I was like, this is Americana. This is as Americana as it gets. You know, this is the roots of the tree that you're looking at. So, and it was moving into like 3 years since I've had a record out. And I was like, this is an eternity. And I've got to get these songs out of me. So
they're
going to
forget about you if you don't.
Yeah, you know, and it's been an uphill climb too, again, you know, reasserting myself and getting back in. But, man, you know, no shame in the game. They really helped me as far as helping me learn what to do on the first record. So I don't have any.
No, yeah. You know.
That's what happened. That's what happened. We couldn't come to it, and they let me walk, and it was peaceful. There could have been blood.
So then you decided to just release this, put your own record label together?
I did, man. I got a manager who'd kind of been going to bat for me at New West, and we weren't getting anywhere. And finally he was like, look, this is what, you know, this is what needs to happen. This is who we're going to need to hire. And I'd kind of known through radio and stuff who to hire, and going through all the proper channels when I worked with New West, like who I liked and whatnot. So I basically just, we hired the team I wanted to do.
Yeah.
So, and just made the record I wanted to make.
And you've got an idea.
Sink or swim, you know?
And you've got an idea too. First CD, you know, what kind of radio stations, what markets that we're going to even be interested in mm-hmm. spinning your kind of stuff mm-hmm. as the ones that maybe some of the actual, what they consider Americana stations aren't into playing real deal traditional country anymore.
Yeah. You know, I knew that I would at least have an opportunity since I was on New West that when they saw me again, they would at least play it. Because that was all I wanted, was just, look, I know this is not what you normally play, but can you give it a chance, you know? Just give it a shot, you know?
Yeah.
What's it going to hurt?
Because, truthfully, when I get about 900 CDs or digital downloads a year, there's not a lot of music that is coming out that sounds like what you put out on this new one.
Oh, thanks, man. Yeah, I'm pretty nuts.
What are you doing?
What are you doing?
You're the big fish in the small pond?
Or the
small fish in the big... whatever.
Whatever it is. But I was scared to death, you know? And I think that's the most free I could have been, was to go against everything and just go with what's in your heart and do it.
Right.
And if it's sink or swim, hey, whatever. You did it your way, you know?
Right.
At the end of the day, I mean... how many people get to say that? Not many that are on a label, I can tell you that.
Now, you wrote all the tunes, is that correct?
I did. I wrote all of the tunes on this one.
And they had been, it's taken quite a long time to write these, or did you have a bunch more?
In fact, there was a couple of them that was probably 2 years old, a couple years, but most of those I wrote probably in the span of maybe, I don't know. I write so much. I mean, prolific doesn't mean great, but... I write a lot. Those came out really quick. I just had something to say, you know, on that one. And a couple of them worked live, too, which I really was like, you know, it's like what John Evans was saying, you know, they work live, but we go into the studio and it's just instrumentation behind me. Just, you know, there's a wall of sound, but it's me and a guitar.
Yeah.
You know, it's all just accompanied by strings and piano. And.
Well, it's sort of traditional country. Production or
definitely.
Arrangements in a
definitely
way.
He John Evans and,
for being
Patrick,
a rocker as much as he is.
Oh man, yeah, don't let him fool you. We sipped out of the bottle and listened to Elvis all night.
Yeah, talking to Jason James. Just to do, we're talking to Jason James. He's playing tonight with a full band over at the Lonesome Rose. Elena Kay opening up that show. So who's going to be playing with you tonight?
Man, I got John Evans on guitar tonight. I've also got, I got the John Evans band. Matt Morris and Patrick Hertzfeld, who, by the way, was the engineer of the record. Pat's great. He's playing drums. He doesn't play on the record, but he does some background singing. He sings like a bird.
And they all play with John.
They play with John. They play it. They're local musicians, too. I know Matt, who's playing bass, has played with just about all the Texas country people at some point or another. But that's John's go-to guys, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
I love playing with them. They bring some energy to it, too, which is great.
Play another tune for us, please.
All right. I tell you what. Tell you what, I'm going to play a little song called World of Make-Believe. That's one from my first record. I've been living in a world of make-believe. I believed that loving me was what you were about. But when you kiss me, I can tell the fire is out. I've been foolish, thinking nothing was up your sleeve. You had me living in a world of make-believe. I've been living in a world of make-believe. Saying only the things you wanted me to see. It took tonight when you walked out on me to wake me up from this world of make-believe. In my heart you adored. Little did I know what reality had in store. For loving you just ain't what it seems.
had me living in a world they make believe. I've been living in a world of make believe, seeing only the things you wanted me to see. It took tonight when you walked out on me to wake me up from this world of make-believe. I was living in a world make-believe.
I'm digging it. Jason James, if you like what you hear, you like to dance to that kind of stuff, or like to do a little two-stepping or whatever, you can do that tonight with Jason James Band over at the Lonesome Rose. I saw on here that you had done a song for a Shiner beer commercial.
Yeah, I did. We did an old Ernest Tubbs song for the Super Bowl. It aired on there. It was awesome. It was pretty cool. I was supposed to be in the actual commercial, and I had some qualms about what they wanted me to wear in it, and I didn't really want to do it.
Oh, really?
So I didn't want to show up.
Okay, what? Now you knew I was going to ask you.
Oh,
what?
Man. It was...
Like a nudie suit or something?
I would have totally wore a nudie suit. No, it was a little howdy-doody for me, and I was like, I'm not wearing the ascot, and no thanks.
Okay. Wow.
But then, you know, I saw, and...
But they didn't actually all together. At least the song was there.
Yeah. It was, it worked out, so.
And a soup exposure during Super Bowl is not bad.
It was pretty cool. I think, you know, I wish it would have been an original, but it was all right. I'm sure Ernest Tubb made a little bit of it.
Now, something like that, did they tell you when it was going to air exactly?
Yeah.
Like, or did you sit through the whole...
No, they didn't tell me. It aired at different times. Like, in fact, some of my girlfriend at the time's parents saw it in Dallas like 10 minutes, 20 minutes before we did. In fact, there was one, we were just pausing. It was right, you know, maybe the third commercial in, and for 30 seconds it went black, and I was like, that's my commercial. That's my, I was like, that's my career in a nutshell.
X'd out.
Yeah, just complete. I mean, we all thought it was like, oh, of course it would be JJ's. You know, but it wasn't. It was awesome. It was a lot of fun.
Cool. Love the stuff on here. If you're into tear in your beer, heartbreaker tunes, Jason definitely can fulfill that. But then you've also been, since you are living in East Texas there, you did get a little of that Louisiana flavor.
Yeah, we had to do that. I couldn't leave that one off there.
And it's called?
Cry on the Bayou.
Cry on the Bayou, yeah. Very cool. I'm digging the CD. Now, do you play much out of Texas? How are you being received?
I'm getting daily mail and places to play in all the festivals and stuff for this summer. I'm going to the West Coast in March. I'm going to be out there for a week or two. And then I'm going to come back. I don't think I'm doing South by Southwest or whatever.
You sure? You know you'll end up.
I probably will. I talk a lot of mess. Every year is my last year of that. But, and then we go hit the East Coast during the summer. And then we come back and do Americana Fests. And then we head over to Europe, I think early October. So,
those people understand definitely what you're doing over there.
They get it. In fact, there was a whole, there was a whole, I did it again. There was a whole UK tour planned last time, and it fell through, and I just thought, oh God, here it comes, because we had like two nights in Ireland sold out. I think Newcastle, England was sold out, and it was coming off my first record, and the label pulled the tour support, and I didn't have any money, and I was like, man, if that would have happened in America, I don't know, I think I would have probably been crucified. But they were so gracious about it. I put out a public apology. I was like, hey, look, this is the deal, you know, blah, 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 blah. And they were like, oh, no problem, mate. Cheers to you. So I was like, all right, have a pint for me. I was like, but, yeah, I will. I most certainly will. I'm
and now you're depressed. But you're going to go back.
Make it.
You're
gonna yeah, they invited me back. So, and I think it's going to be bigger than it was last time. So cool. Maybe there's a little hype to it, you know?
Yeah.
Maybe there's a little... will he make it this time?
Yeah.
Let me be legal here. You're listening to KSYM San Antonio 90.1 FM. Today is National Bartender Day.
My goodness.
Would you happen to have a tune in your repertoire that would fit that?
I've got a bunch of songs that'll make you want to drink. It'll keep the bartender busy. I don't know if I know them offhand. What is that? I was thinking of, there's a couple when there's that James Taylor song. Well, I'm just a bartender. I don't mind my work. I don't mind the money at all.
Yeah,
we gotta play that one.
All right. We'll just do one. Well, I tell you what. We'll let you go. You're not playing till later this evening. Lena Kay opening up the show, I believe, at 9. Mm-hmm. You're coming on with John Evans Band at 11, and it's going to be a great.
It's going to be a great time.
It's going to be fun.
Yeah.
It's a fun place, and they're getting some dancers out there, and you can definitely fit the bill for them to do a belt, you know. Rubbing the belt buckles together doing some two-stepping for sure.
Oh, I hope so.
All right. Well, appreciate you very much for stopping by. What should we play off of the track?
I tell you what, I want to play this Seems Like Tears Ago. Play the title track.
Hang on.
Do it.
Any setup to this?
This is the title track. Seems Like Tears Ago, man. This was one of my favorites. I want this to be a single.
I'm surprised it's not.
It might be coming up after.
It might.
Since I'm my own label, I get to.
And you know, and since we've played it.
Oh, wow.
We're not stuck to no one song.
Let's do it.
Okay. Jason James, thanks for stopping by.
Brother. Appreciate it.
Congratulations on the new CD. I think it's going to be definitely one of my favorites of the year.
Thank you.
And there needs to be more music like this.
Definitely. I hope so, man. And, I hope it sparks some stuff.
Curious to see it tonight with the. With John and the band.
Yeah.
It'll be rocking. All right. Thanks, man.
All right.
Appreciate
thank
it.
You.